Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Brian Wade. Worlds Apart is a program that looks to investigate how racism, ethnocentrism, cultural and social divide manifest themselves within our society. Worlds Apart will consider the historic, scientific, cultural, and social factor that perpetuates these issues. Additionally, Worlds Apart was created to serve as a constructive dialogue piece around issues pertaining to race, a topic that at times is not comfortable for people to broach or engage in. This program is in its ninth year, and the premise for the program is to really, again, look at the issue of race structurally and also to provide, I think, solutions or to look at best practices around how can we move forward as a society to address our issues. At this time, I'd like to introduce my guest. She's quite known to some in the central Pennsylvania region, specifically the Harrisburg area. She's an advocate. Some call her a troublemaker, but she's probably been called a lot of things. But at this time, I want to introduce my guest, Ms. Annette Antone. Welcome to Worlds Apart.
Thank you very much.
Yes, Ms. Antone, give us some background about yourself and what you do, please.
Well, I think the most important thing I am, and that's a mother of eight kids.
Eight kids.
I have six boys and two girls, and I was so a hands-on mother.
Okay.
And I think that's important.
So when you say hands-on, what does that mean?
I cook three meals a day.
That means you were bugging them or whatever?
I was bugging them. I was right there at the house.
So right,
that's
right.
The important thing.
Right,
I didn't
right.
have to. I did a lot of my work upstairs in my attic.
Okay.
And I was there. Everybody right. else's kids were at my house.
Okay. Oh, okay.
And my kids were there.
Okay.
Well, I published the paper.
Okay.
And I had art boards in my attic.
Okay, very
They'd
good.
They'd go to sleep and I'd work on the paper upstairs.
Okay.
We started the paper in 1960.
You're the president and CEO of the paper, correct?
I am the owner. Yes, I am.
Okay.
I'm the chief cook and bottle washer.
Okay, all right. So you started the paper back in 1960?
1960 is okay. right. And we did only started it as if because nobody was getting any news coverage in the Harrisburg papers.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, the main paper in Harrisburg ignored what was happening. They ignored what was happening in the black community. They ignored what was happening in the suburbs.
Mm-hmm.
They only printed what they wanted to print. So
now, what do you think that was around politics and business?
And everything, even every small little thing.
But that's changed now when you look at the paper news.
They just catered to certain people. But now it's changed quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
But you still have to keep the heat on.
Okay.
And if you don't, they slip back. In other words, if you have an event, such as the recent Human Relations Commission dinner,
right.
unless you bug them, unless it's printed someplace else, they will ignore it up until the weekend before the happening.
Mm-hmm. So do you think that's decision-making in terms of determining what's news or how important they see that news is? Do you think that's their decision, you know, when they look at what...
Yeah, I think it is. And they're controlled by a big conglomerate.
Mm-hmm.
And it isn't necessarily the people that work in the city of Harrisburg that have control. It's often their bend and their take is dictated by somebody else sometimes. And what's important, they don't see what's important to them may not be what's important to the people on the street.
Right. So you see yourself as the paper in 1960 as an alternative to the predominant news media.
That's what it was. And then it very quickly changed when they saw that something else was being printed. And it went faster than I ever dreamed.
How do you think you influenced, though, the mainstream newspaper in terms of now creating... You think they saw you as a competition then or just saying, well, maybe she's looking at something that we need to look at?
At first they laughed.
Okay.
Okay.
I know that feeling. Believe me, I do. But
yeah. And the second thing they did was try to buy me out.
Did they?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Then they tried to threaten me, say, we're going to have six people on the street and you won't sell any advertising.
Hmm.
And they tried to buy me out.
Hmm.
And one man came to me.
We don't have to name it. Right.
And he said, money talks. And I said, I don't speak the language.
But if to stay in business, though, you do need money, though, would you say?
Oh, yeah, but... No, here's the way it is. When we started the paper, we did it on a shoestring, on nothing.
I know that feeling too.
And we did it because my husband was a deputy attorney general.
Okay.
And he worked at the state, but
mm-hmm.
then he would come home at night and we'd discuss things and he had a different perspective and sometimes we'd argue
okay.
and sometimes we agreed. You
right,
know?
Right.
And I saw so many things that needed to be done. Everything from traffic lights to inner city housing.
Mm-hmm.
And I just had to do something about it.
Now, and we've talked several times, you know, as mm-hmm. far as you've seen my program, you know, over the years. And in some ways, I think we're kindred spirits, you know, in terms of, you know, creating something that in a lot of ways had not been in some ways addressed or brought attention to.
Yeah,
although your
paper
doesn't exclusively look at the issue of race, but you don't shy away from it at all in terms of looking at that substantively. And I know when we go into our second set and third set, I'm going to talk more about that. But you created something that responded and addressed the need.
That's right.
Now, when you look back, I guess when you started and I wanted to sort of get your ideal and look back historically in Harrisburg. How have you seen race relations evolve? You know, you think it's getting better? I know I have my thoughts about it, but...
Yes, it's definitely better. When I first got involved in the city of Harrisburg, and it was all the way back when the League of Women Voters didn't put Jesse Jackson in their flyers. Mm-hmm. And I went down there literally with, like, Carrie Nation, screaming and yelling, mm-hmm. because it was that kind of thing. And then I got involved in housing in the city of Harrisburg. And I filed papers, and they were just putting people out on the street. People were living in very bad conditions, mm-hmm. in the center of Harrisburg. Right. And I filed papers and got the one place declared a historic district.
And where's that located in
Fox
Harrisburg?
Ridge.
Okay. And
they were, it was mostly black. But the people, it was almost 100% black, but the people were told that they were going to take their houses, don't repair them, so their houses just fell apart.
You said they were like eminent domain kinds of things?
The city said they were going to take it, and the state, really, excuse me, the state said they were going to take it.
Right, get somebody upset with you.
So anyway, yeah, but they didn't, and they just kept forcing those people further and further. They would say, oh, well, let it go for taxes, and they'd just move out. Mm-hmm. And eventually they didn't do that, but I was very, very lucky in this way, is that I had boys. My first group of kids were all boys. Mm-hmm. And we went down there and started to work on those houses. And if you could get a better education, race relations, than to work in the community like that, it's not possible. My kids learned more by working on houses and tearing things down and digging ditch for sewers and things.
So it's one thing to have sort of a head knowledge of dealing with other people, but it's not until you really get there and
That's
you're
right.
dealing with them on a daily
That's
basis
right.
do you
we
get a good
their
sense.
Houses. My kids would go into their houses, they would have lunch, they'd do want some lemonade. And at one point there was the kids were shooting crap on the street.
Well, let me pause for a break. I hate to pause on that note, but we're going to come
ahead.
Right back. We got to pause from words from our sponsors. If you're just not tuning in, I have Miss Annette Ironton, who's the present CEO of the Paxson Herald. We're going to pause from words from our sponsors. Stay tuned. We'll be right back to Worlds Apart.
Support for Worlds Apart is provided in part by York Foundation, a community foundation, and Susquehanna Falscraft Company.
Through the Community Care Fund, United Way supports programs like the American Red Cross CPR training that saved Vilma Thompson's life.
I just say what a wonderful thing it is to be alive and know that you owe your life to somebody because they took the time to learn how to save a life.
I'd like to thank the community. I'd like to thank everyone that donates to the United Way. And I would like to ask those that don't donate to the United Way to find it in their heart to do so.
Plan your sweet getaway. Visit HersheyPA.com.
The only reason I chose Central Penn is because it gives you a small individual experience, so each and every teacher knows who you are.
The professors know you one-on-one, not by a number, your name.
Not only do we have textbooks to learn from, but we're getting people who are actually in the field.
When they teach you what they have learned, it's actually really good because you know, it's like, wow, this person knows what they're talking about.
I have the drive and the motivation to succeed, and I think the teachers help show me that in myself.
Faculty dedicated to your future success.
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by the Bon Ton.
Whether it's in the city, the country, or somewhere in between, owning your own home means something special, something comfortable and secure. No wonder it's a dream we all share. We're the Pennsylvania Housing Finance Agency, working to put safe, affordable housing within reach of every citizen. Find out more by visiting phfa.org, because it doesn't have to be just a dream.
See you.
Welcome back to Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Brian Wade. If you're just now tuning in, I have with me as my guest, President CEO of the Paxson Herald, Miss Annette Antone, and she's my guest this evening. We've talked extensively about race relations and different her experiences and really getting to know people for people and not making judgments. And she's here just to talk and share about her experiences and to talk about her newspaper. And when we left it up on the word, you said the crap, and I think you were talking about rolling dice, I believe. I think you were talking about rolling dice when you were talking about it. But go ahead, continue what you were talking about as well as this crap.
These minority black kids were shooting crap on the street in Bow Street, and it was a big wide sidewalk, but the police said, get out of here, you can't do that. Well, where did they have to go? So I've got a table, Redwood picnic table, and put in the backyard. The first house that was fixed in Fox Ridge, actually, because my kids were all working on it.
Fox Ridge is located where in
it's
Harrisburg?
It's right about a block and a half from the Capitol.
Okay, but it wasn't because we don't know it as Fox Ridge now.
Well, it is Fox Ridge.
They still call it that?
Called Fox Ridge, okay. But about I would say 80% of the houses were empty.
Okay.
The roofs were all gone. It was bad. Mm-hmm. And I put this table back in the backyard of this house, and no fence or anything. I said, you kids can go back there. You can use this backyard. Yeah. Well, they did.
To go back and shoot craps.
That's right. They can do whatever they wanted to do back there. They weren't doing anything hard to harm anybody.
Right.
So they did. And it was sat there for 3 years. Mm-hmm. And there were removable benches, an umbrella, and everything. And nobody touched it.
Mm. Okay.
So, in other words, and I was very lucky is that I did not grow up with a silver spoon in my mouth.
Mm-hmm.
So I could relate to people who didn't have anything.
What does that say, though, you know, in terms of your experience there over those periods of years? And as I said off camera, that was really your first substantive experience. I'm not saying the only one, but in terms of the ongoing.
It was more of a nitty gritty. I'd been involved with the League of Women Voters. I didn't put Jesse Jackson in it, and I would go down and print articles and raise living hell, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But that was I spent time down there. I was there. My kids were down there. They went in the houses of everybody there, and there was they were accepted, and my kids accepted them, and it was a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
And in my lifetime, I was without.
Mm-hmm. So when I asked you earlier, you think things have gotten better for, you could say, minority groups? I don't even like that word really, but it is, you know. But you know, people of color. You think things have gotten better? Although my experiences, as I do more substantive research in this area, shows that issues like racial segregation in housing is becoming more pronounced. And when you look at the black-white achievement gap, I'm seeing retrenchments or reversals. But on one hand, you see things as getting better.
Because I was there in the beginning, mm-hmm. when it was really, really bad.
Okay.
And everything was redlined.
Okay.
And blacks couldn't get anywhere. They couldn't live anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
It was really, really difficult.
Mm-hmm.
And people were being, oh my God, they throw people in the back of paddy wagons and handcuff them and then go all over the whole city with chains on their legs and hands until they banged into each other.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it was a cruel, cruel atmosphere.
Kind of brutal experience.
Brutal.
Right?
It was a brutal atmosphere.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, I do think you're right that there are worlds apart. There's a couple different kinds of worlds apart, though.
Okay.
All white people aren't the same. All black people aren't the same.
Right, right.
They're worlds, literally, worlds apart.
You think economics is the main dividing line?
No, I don't think it's all economics.
We'll talk about it. What do you think?
It's psychologically.
Okay.
And what's important to them.
Mm-hmm.
I think what's important to people is what divides them.
Okay.
In other words, if you're after, we were talking about rings and
diamonds. I wasn't going to bring that up, but go ahead.
And see, diamonds and jewelry and things like that aren't important to me.
Mm-hmm.
And never have been.
Okay.
And
you're atypical then for a female, huh? No, I got to get a whole bunch of people with letters and emails. These stereotypes of women.
I'm a pie baker, man.
Okay.
anyway, I think that what you want to achieve in your lifetime, what's important for you to do with, say, your spare time,
mm-hmm.
or when you retire, which I think is people live their whole life focused on retirement,
right.
Which is, frankly, that's pretty bad.
Mm-hmm.
I get into a group of white people. Let's say I'm with the white people,
okay.
And they all white. And all they talk about is where they're going to eat, where they're going to travel, where the places they've been.
Mm.
Man, it turns me off totally.
Okay.
Totally.
All right.
I would rather hear somebody talk about something more nitty-gritty.
So what do you hear? Is that what you hear when you're then around people of color? More nitty-gritty
sometimes.
Kinds of things?
No.
Well, it depends on their economic status.
It depends on what their goal, more or less what their goal in life is.
Goal in life is.
They may not have achieved it yet,
mm-hmm.
but they're working toward it. And that's in their head. It's ingrained in their head.
Mm-hmm.
And they're working toward that kind of a life, that kind of a lifestyle, or that kind of an end to their good God, I mean, it's really terrible to think of working all your life for a goal that you're ready to die, and that's what you're working for.
Right, right.
It's so empty.
So you have a mindset that you'll work until, I guess, you can't work anymore, correct?
That's right.
Okay. And I'm hoping to do the same thing.
I don't know when that'll be.
Yeah.
Long time.
Okay, well, and I hope you realize that a long time that you're, you know, looking to attain. But it's good, I think, when you have a passion, and it's clear that your paper, in terms of really providing an alternative voice, or not alternative that the information is alternative, but at least provide a perspective that mainstream media is not providing.
Well, and even if it is, you maybe do it from a different perspective.
Right, right.
I try to cover all minority events as much as I possibly can, and I'm very comfortable in the minority community. I'm on the board of the NAACP, the Sickle Cell Council.
Right.
Homer Floyd called and asked me to help him with his dinner.
Right, right. I know. That's how he came on this program. Yeah. He said, why aren't you on Worlds Apart?
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, and I said, and I called him, and I said, you got to get on that program.
Right, right,
but
right.
See, I think maybe my excitement about even the Human Relations Commission is different.
Okay.
Because I don't think it's very clinical at all.
Mm-hmm.
I think you have this poor son of a gun of a person who sees no way out and nobody to turn to.
Right.
The fact they have the Human Relations Commission to turn to, that's exciting.
Mm-hmm.
I can't talk about it and be clinical.
Right, I understand what you're saying.
I really can't.
Right, because real world. What I wanted to ask you, though, and then we'll probably address this more when we come back from break.
Okay.
How do you see those in the African-American community that are in the media? Do you think that they're really addressing the issues that should be addressed? And I know that you don't have to say the same thing the same way, but do you think those that have had opportunities to be in the media that probably are more independent, because I think predominantly that when you're in mainstream media, you're pretty well scripted about what you can say. So I wanted to think, how do you think the independent black media is doing in terms of addressing these issues? And we'll respond to that when we come back, because we're going to go to break.
Okay.
Just not tuning in, I have Ms. Annette Antone, who's the present CEO of the Paxton Herald, as my guest, advocate, troublemaker sometimes.
No,
I didn't call you that, Kate, but she's my guest. What we'd like to do now is pause some words from our sponsor. Stay tuned, we'll be right back.
Hershey Foods Corporation supports the efforts of Worlds Apart in promoting the understanding, acceptance, and value of diversity.
Words like skilled, expert, and nationally recognized. When you need to have confidence as well as courage. When it's your health, your body, your life. We have the finest team of specialists waiting to help. WellSpan Health, the region's most comprehensive healthcare system. WellSpan Health, for the journey that is life.
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by the Bonton Stores Foundation. Worlds Apart is underwritten by Graham Packaging Company. Graham Packaging Company values diversity in the workplace as a competitive advantage.
Hi, I'm Bob Darr, Vice President of Harrisburg Toyota Chrysler Jeep. We're proud to be corporate sponsors of Worlds Apart. And if you're ever in the market for a new Toyota, Chrysler Jeep, or a used car, come on down and see us.
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by Wolf Printing.
Why do you and me have to be?
You hold me to be self-evident that all.
Welcome back to Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Brian Wade. If just now tuning in, I have with me is my guest, Ms. Annette Antone. And I've enjoyed our conversation. Always too short, but I'm sure we'll see each other again. We can talk more about this. When we went to break, I was asking you, you know, from your perspective, being in the, you know, written media, as you observe the community, specifically in the Harrisburg area, how good of a job do you think those blacks that are independent How do you think they're doing in terms of communicating important information to the community in general? Not only the black community, but the community in general.
I mean, some of them are good and some of them aren't. Mm-hmm. Some of them you get the impression that they're only in it for what they get out of it for themselves, mm-hmm. and others will wait. Very few will wade into things like you do.
Mm-hmm. Right. Wade, like Brian Wade. Okay, wade in the water. Yeah, Wade is Wade, right. I like that. It's really good. Might use that somewhere.
That's true.
But, believe me, this is something, I guess, if I didn't really have a passion about it, that I would have maybe, it'd been nice to choose something else so light. But you would think, and we talked about this, these impressions that people, we call them social constructs in the sociologic sense, where, you know, you create this image of a group of people and then you demonize them and then you create these kinds of, you know, segregative housing patterns and school patterns, all this type of thing. And the thing about it is, to be fair, it happens to whites, though. If you look at the early history of America, you know, when you look at the Jews, the Irish, but they were only there temporarily, though. But in the color of their skin allowed them and eventually created the opportunity for new.
When I was a kid, I grew up in northwestern Pennsylvania, mm-hmm. and they were that way with Catholics.
Okay.
And they would put marks
discriminate
on
based on religion.
They would put marks on your curb.
Wow.
And you couldn't get jobs.
Right. And that's such a sad commentary to think
that's
that.
That's true.
And people think that kind of stuff is going away, but you still hear about these hate tensions and the religious and ethnic divide. And you look throughout the world, not only just with just whites, you know, when you look at Bosnia, when you look at what's going on in Africa and other, I mean, this just, for some reason, we can't seem to be as civilized as we say we are. You know,
no,
we talk about being higher than animals, but animals, I think, are a little more civil than we are in terms
Democrats,
of how we get along.
Democrats and Republicans can't get along, so how in the name of heaven do they expect the Shiites and the Sunnis and all those people that they should get together and form a government?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah? Why can't we?
Mm-hmm.
We don't do that either. I mean, we have this terrible divide,
mm-hmm.
and it's very hard to get through it.
When you look at the state of education specifically, you know, and I'm a consultant while I work in the area of trying to close an achievement gap for a school, Susquehanna Township, to be specific. And I want to applaud them for the work that they're doing, and other schools are looking to do that. But with Susquehanna Township being an affluent school district, you would think a black-white achievement gap. But when you look at the state of education, are you hopeful? What kinds of recommendations would you offer in terms of how do we sort of close these gaps, you know, in education?
I think it's really very difficult, and I think each person has to take a little bit of a responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
You really can't do an overall thing because it just doesn't work. It doesn't seem to work. Now, my kids all went to parochial schools.
Mm-hmm.
And to tell you the truth, they were integrated.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody even thought a thing about it.
Right.
You know, never thought a thing about it.
Do you think that's a positive or a negative when you have integrated schools with different ethnic groups?
I think it's very positive. Mm-hmm. Because after all, you can't live on an island.
Mm-hmm.
You have to realize, and when people know each other, they realize they're not that different.
Mm-hmm. What about the state of politics? Now, you have Governor Rendell and you have Len Swann running for these offices, and much has been made about the fact that Len Swann is black. What's your take on that in terms of should blacks just automatically vote for him because he's black?
I would hope whites don't automatically vote for whites and blacks don't automatically vote for blacks, mm-hmm. because it's what's in their mind and what's in their thinking,
mm-hmm.
because it gets pretty difficult. Right. You can't vote for somebody just because of their color.
Mm-hmm.
That's bad.
Right. Well, do you think that Len Swann has really said enough? You know, I'll speak for myself. I've heard him say very little about anything around disparities that relates to academics or health care or whatever.
I think he's very weak. He may kick a good football, but mm-hmm. I don't think he, you know, mm-hmm. I don't think he has the intellectual capability yet. Now, mm-hmm. I'm not saying he won't ever.
Well, that'd get you in trouble by saying intellectual capability, or you think he hasn't really...
He doesn't have the mental capability, mm-hmm. but I mean he hasn't articulated.
Right, the social issues that need to be addressed.
Right.
And it seems like even with the Democrats, they don't bring race unless it's brought up, you know, or unless some ways they're sort of maneuvered into having to address it. They'll talk about other things, you know, in terms of, you know, addressing, you know, education as far as providing more money. But really, the Cold War is still around the issue of race.
Everybody wiggles around it. That's
yeah.
true.
And I don't know why people just can't call it for what it is. And your thoughts on that briefly?
Well, I do think that you're correct, mm-hmm. that it's going to take people who actually work in the system,
mm-hmm.
like you're doing now.
Mm-hmm.
That makes a big difference,
right?
Because you can't do it alone, but you need help, and you can't do it alone.
Briefly talk about some of the articles that you've done historically in your paper. I know you have an article here of Judge Clarence Morrison.
Yeah,
briefly talk about that, if you would.
Well, this isn't in my paper.
Mm-hmm.
We also do graphics work.
Right,
but
right.
This is I was on the board of the Heinz Center, which is basically a minority
mm-hmm.
for years.
Right.
And this is a, we did this tribute to Judge Morrison, mm-hmm. to Steve Reed, and to myself,
mm-hmm.
and so on. And this, we had Alex Haley's brother there. Okay. We had Stedman,
okay.
Graham.
Yeah.
We had
Oprah's boyfriend.
Yeah, we had them all there, and which brought the focus of to this black senior center, mm-hmm. the John Hines Center down on 4th Street,
right.
And unbelievable. And Bob Kimmel, who worked at the Paxton Herald part time, mm-hmm. well, he was the executive director with no pay.
Mm-hmm.
So we did very well.
Okay. If somebody wanted to subscribe to your paper, can you give a phone number?
Sure. We're delivered every week, and there's free classifieds.
Mm-hmm.
You can sell and buy. And the phone number is 717-545-5388.
And your circulation is how many?
I would say around 20,000.
And you're the largest, what, independent newspaper in the region?
Except for Philadelphia and Pittsburgh. Yeah.
Okay, in the state, so you're up
yeah.
there. Okay.
Yeah, we're right up there. And I think the reason we stay up there is that people get addicted to it.
Mm-hmm.
They might want to hear what I'm saying, but they also get addicted to the classifieds.
Well, again, you know, we don't have much time, like 15 seconds. I want to thank you for appearing on the program and continued success in terms of your advocacy and the support that maybe some people don't know that you've done in the black community.
Well, like I said to you before, I think when you die, you want to leave footprints in the sand of time, and that's what I'd like to do.
Well, thank you so much on those words. And for the footprints in the sand of time, I'm Brian Wade for Worlds Apart. What we'd like to do is wish you a good evening. Good evening, good night, and God bless.
The African American History Minute. Today's trivia question is, what year did Marcus Garvey found the Universal Negro Improvement Association? Today's featured African American is Andrew Young. He was twice elected mayor of Atlanta. He was the first African American to represent a Southern district in Congress after Reconstruction and was appointed ambassador of the United Nations. Born in New Orleans in 1932, he graduated from Howard University at age 19. He then decided to become a minister and attended Hartford Theological Seminary. In 1971, he joined SCLC, organizing marches and demonstrations. For more information about Andrew Young, visit our website at historyminute.org. Now, back to our trivia question. What year did Marcus Garvey found the Universal Negro Improvement Association? The answer is 1914. Until next time, remember, we're standing on the shoulders of giants.